Hey Cameron, this is my real last name, Coward here. You know, escape rooms are a lot like taxes. Confusing, frustrating, and you feel accomplished when you finally figure them out. But instead of trying to solve puzzles, I'm doing a series in which I design them. All the fun without the self-doubt regarding my own intelligence. Today's puzzle is a compass lock. It's like a combination lock, but with cardinal directions instead of numbers. The idea here is that the player finds the dial and the clue elsewhere in the escape room. They use those to solve the puzzle, which will then open a door so they can proceed, or maybe a box with the next clue. For this demo, success changes the light from red to green because I don't have the budget for fancy electronic locks. But hey, in your escape room, it could spit out gold coins or unleash a kraken. Take a look at the physical device. The compass is just for show, like the wing on your clapped out Honda Civic, but the compass needle moves with the pink dial, which looks neat and hammers home the idea that the solution involves cardinal directions. Before I dive into the technical details, here's a clip of my wife tackling the puzzle.
Can I use my phone?
Yeah.
Can you tell me what this word means?
Elucidate.
Yeah.
It just means like figure out, decipher.
North, east, south, south, southeast, southwest. Okay. North.
The light on there on the thing will change green if you win. I mean, you had the right idea, but
I know I need to do it like a lock.
I just don't know what order you did it in. What are the other directions?
North, east, south. Oh, west. Never eat soggy waffles.
Okay. Hold it. You're not supposed to be in the video, buddy. Come here.
I missed that second one, too. Green.
You solved it. Hooray.
Aside from a brief brain fart where she forgot Wes existed, she nailed it. Impressive, right? Or maybe I just like my wife. This should give you some idea of how long this puzzle takes. Of course, you can always make it easier or more difficult with your choice of clue. To understand how this works on a technical level, let's time travel to the distant past of a couple weeks ago.
So I just received the most important component for this lock, which is this magnetometer, and it will let us see the orientation of the magnets that's going to be moving around the outside. We're going to monitor that with a Seed Studio Zhao RP2040 microcontroller development board, which I'm choosing because it's so small. So these will connect together. This will monitor this and tell us how the magnet's moving around the outside, which we can use some code then to use that as a combination lock to unlock the solenoid.
As you saw, I thought this was going to be a very straightforward project. I figured the digital compass would tell me the direction of the magnet, and that would be that. But the reality was far more frustrating. First, I looked at the raw numbers output by the compass module. Those weren't very intuitive, so I wrote some Python code to visualize the values in 3D space. Here, I'm just moving a magnet in a circle around the compass module. That was a bit better, but the values were still erratic and didn't seem to match up well with the actual movement of the magnet. I tried several ways to get better results, but eventually I just abandoned that idea. Fast forward a week and I was too annoyed to continue. It was like watching a soap opera, but with fewer love triangles. So I needed a new solution.
All right, so new plan, since the compass module didn't work and was acting too erratically, we are going to use reed switches instead. These are tiny little switches that kind of act like buttons, but they're triggered when you bring a magnet close enough to the switch. There's a little internal mechanism that'll flip on and allow voltage to pass through. So we'll put one of these at each of the cardinal directions around the compass. rotating mechanism will have a magnet inside, and when it crosses over each route switch, it will trigger it, and that will, we can register that and know that they turn it to like east and west and so on. But if we look at how these reed switches work, they don't trigger instantly. They take a moment to trigger. If you look at the oscilloscope, it goes up when the magnet first comes by. It goes up a little bit, then kind of levels out around 2 volts or so, and then goes up to the 3.3 volts that the logic of the microcontroller actually uses. And that's a problem, because at 2 volts around there, you're kind of almost halfway between 0 and the 3.3 used by the microcontroller, so that's going to kind of float in this danger zone of whether the microcontroller is going to recognize it as high or low. So in this area, it'll probably recognize, kind of flip back and forth between whether it thinks it's high or low. So it will register it, the magnet turning the reed switch on. It'll register that multiple times, possibly. So we'll need a way to sort that out. And I can show you this, how that actually works, if we look at it again. So I have just a small magnet here, and when I move it close to here, you'll see on the oscilloscope, you'll see a trigger, and it'll kind of have that pattern. So, see, there we get that again. In code, we can compensate for this. So we know that the user isn't going to be, say, going north, 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 north multiple times in a row, right? They're going to go like north, then to west, then to maybe then back to north. So we can, in the code, we can just say that it can't register the same cardinal direction twice in a row. And that will let us handle this, because even if it's bouncing back and forth, and even if the microcontroller is seeing it bounce from high to low, we're only going to register it the first time. And then once we go to another cardinal direction, like east, then you can allow it to register north again. And I'll show how to accomplish that in the code. It's pretty simple, but I wanted to show you why we need to do that in the code before we get to that point. And the reason is because that ledge right there is a dirty area that we're going to get possibly some anomalous results. So now we'll move on over to the code, and you can see how we'll compensate for that.
Now, before I explain the code, I want to make sure you understand the hardware. Inside the pink dial, there's just a collection of magnets here. Those need to be oriented so they pull the needle of the compass towards them. And then on the base of the device, this compass is just glued in place. And then on the back, there are 4 reed switches connected to a Seed Studio Zhao RP2040 microcontroller. Try to maintain an image of this hardware in your head while I cover the code. All right, so we need the Adafruit NeoPixel library to control the onboard RGB LED, the one that we set from red to green. That's connected internally to pin 12, but to use that, it needs power, which we control through pin 11. There's only a single LED, so 1 NeoPixel. The read switches are connected to analog pins 0, 1, 2, and 3. Then we initialize the NeoPixels, or just the single NeoPixel. These store the most recent, the current position that the dial is at, and then the last registered position. This first array stores the code sequence to win. So this should be like the solution. You can change this, and you can also change the length of it. If you do change the length of it, you need to change that code length integer to match. And then this array stores the sequence that the player has entered by turning the dial. And this array also needs to be the same length as that array. And we use fives because the user can't actually enter a 5. They can only enter 0, 1, 2, and 3, which correspond to the for cardinal directions. So 5 is just a safe number that we know that they won't be able to actually enter themselves. Then in setup, we turn on serial. We don't actually need that for anything as far as functionality is concerned. It's really just for debugging, and so you can see what's going on behind the scenes by looking at the serial output. Then we get the NeoPixels ready to go. Then we turn on that pin 11 power output so that the LED can get power and turn on. Then we set that LED to red. Then we set the 4 read switch input pins as inputs. Then in our main loop, we have delay of 100 milliseconds. So after that delay, every 100 milliseconds, we check each of the 4 analog input pins from the read switches. We check to see if those exceed the threshold. If they do, then we consider that the dial is in that position. You can change these thresholds if you need to. You just want it so that it reliably exceeds that threshold when it's on and reliably is below that threshold when it's not on. So you can tweak those thresholds if you need to. If it does exceed that threshold, if any of the pins exceed the threshold, then we assume that the dial is at that position and we record that position. Then we check to see if that position matches the last position it was at. If it does match, that means that they haven't turned it to a new direction yet, right? So this is checking every 100 milliseconds. So it's checking 10 times a second. So if we didn't do this, then it would just, and they turned it to say north, then it would register north 10 times per second. And we don't want that. So we only register a new position if it changes. So that's what we're doing here, checking to see if it changes. If it does change, then we add call this function to add the new position to the sequence that they're entering. And that's this function here. So it takes the sequence array, it takes the newest value, and it takes the length of the sequence array. It then moves every value in the array, it moves that one position forward, and then adds the new value to the final position. Then it just prints out the values of all of the positions in the sequence. Then every time we run the loop, we also check to see if they have solved the puzzle, which is this function, which is down here. So the way this works is it runs through the two arrays, it runs through these two arrays, and it checks each position to see if they match. So it checks to see if this matches this, then this, and this. And each time it checks that, if they do match, it adds 1 point to the score. Then it checks to see if, once it runs through the array, it checks to see if that score is more than or is equal to the length of the sequence. So in this case, if it would be 8 or more, that means that all 8 of these match, which means that they have won. So when that happens, it just sets all the positions back to 5, which basically just keeps it from registering a win over and over again. Then we just print out that they solved it. And then in my case, all I'm doing when they solve it is changing the color of that LED to green. So I'm just, it was red before, now it's green. And that's just to indicate that they won. But if you were to use this in an actual escape room, you would replace this with something to show, like say that they won, like say, triggering an electronic lock or something like that. So you would do that here. Probably you would have a function call here that would go to your function to do whatever it is you want to do. And yeah, so that's how this code works. I mean, obviously you can see that I put a ton of comments in here, so you should be able to follow along if you want to use this. Pretty simple, right? If you're using the puzzle in your own escape room, you could just have some other function trigger instead of flipping the LED from red to green. I think it would work nicely with an electronic lock. During assembly, keep in mind that the reed switches are more delicate than a politician's promises. Handle with care or they'll break faster than a New Year's resolution. I used a Seed Studio Xiao RP2040 development board because size matters. Not in that way, get your mind out of the gutter. Any dev board compatible with the Arduino IDE works as long as it has at least 4 analog input pins. Why analog? It seems like these should be digital, right? These reed switches are either on or off. But I found that isn't quite true. Even with a pull down or pull up resistor, I was getting some current flow when the switches were supposed to be off, and I wasn't always getting high enough voltage when they were on to consistently trigger as high. So I connected the reed switches to the analog pins and chose a threshold for the code to register them as on or off. Because it looks at the analog readings, it's possible to tweak that threshold to get results as reliable as your grandmother's disapproval. Now your clue. Get creative, make it rhyme if you're feeling fancy. Here's mine. Just remember, no consecutive directions and only adjacent moves. It's like a king in chess, but without the royalty and drama. So there you have it. If you want to use this puzzle, grab the files. The 3D prints, Arduino code, and schematics are all available. Good luck, and don't forget to send me pics of your masterpiece. If you want to see more cool electronics projects like this one, be sure to subscribe. Thanks.